D.Y. Patel International University, Akurdi, Pune. Carrying legacy of 36 years of education excellence. Following the footsteps of Padma Shri Dr. D.Y. Patel. Under the graceful guidance of Founder Vice Chancellor Professor Prabhat Ranjan, a nuclear fusion scientist, a futurist. Carve the path to your future career with D.Y. Patel International University, Akurdi, Pune. A new era postgraduate and undergraduate courses, trendsetting multi-track specializations, forward-looking pedagogy, modern infrastructure, well-qualified faculty, state-of-the-art laboratories, and many more. For more details, please visit our website dypiu.ac.in or call us on +91 9071 123434.
Good evening, everyone. I welcome you all to our second day of induction program. We all had a wonderful session yesterday. We hope we will have a wonderful session today. Today, the topic for today's session is technology and innovative ecosystems in India. With this, I would like to welcome our VC Sir, Professor Prabhat Ranjan. Professor Prabhat Ranjan is a nuclear fusion scientist, a futurist, an educator, an innovator, an entrepreneur, and a science commutator. From 2013 to 2018, he was heading India's technology think tank, that is the TIFAC, Technology Information Forecasting and Assessment Council in Delhi, as its executive director. TIFAC is an autonomous body of Department of Science and Technology. TIFAC developed Technology Vision 2035 during his tenure, which was released by Honorable Prime Minister in Jan 2016. PMO has directed all its departments and ministries to follow this document and take the agenda forward under the leadership of Niti Aayog. Earlier, he worked for nearly 20 years, making important contribution to nuclear fusion research as a scientist in India and USA. After this, he worked on Chandrayaan 2's mission, wildlife, agriculture, and brain-computer interface. He has brought smiles on faces of many persons with severe disability by innovative assistant technology for more than 11 years. He is also a co-founder of Sun Technovation in Gandhinagar, which focuses on technology-based innovations. With this, I welcome you, Professor. I would like you to say a few words.
Thank you, Rashmi. I welcome all the audience. Today is a special day. We have a very important guest, Dr. H.K. Mittal, joining us in Delhi at part of my tenure there. We used to sit in the same building. We used to have many discussions. He was heading Technology Development Board at that time, and I was in TIFAC. And later on, of course, his parent body was the Department of Science Technology, which was also my parent body. So he's made a lot of contribution to support technology-based innovation across the country, and that's why I requested him to join. I would not want to take more time except trying to say that we are trying to encourage the students to actually become entrepreneur from day one. And that's why we are very second of the induction program. We have brought a top person like Dr. Harkesh Mittal to talk to all of you, to excite you, and to guide you people into the innovation ecosystem that exists in the country. Many people are not aware of this. So I'll not take more of time, and we'll interact as we go along. So Dr. Mittal, welcome to this event. Thank you so much for joining us.
Welcome, Dr. Harkesh Mittal. Dr. Harkesh Mittal, I would like to introduce you to one and all. An alumni of the National Dairy Research Institute, 1981, and Indian Institute of Management, Ahmedabad, Sri Harkesh Mittal had been instrumental in giving a new vibrancy to promoting the innovation and entrepreneurial acumen among the wide section of Indian entrepreneurs, ranging from simple grassroots industries to high-end deep techno enterprises. He was responsible for conceptualization and implementation of flagship program on innovation titled National Innovative for Development and Hastening Innovation, that is the NIDI. He is a key figure in promotion and innovation of startups in India, and his service are used by many government departments in involving and evaluating programs on innovation and entrepreneurship. Shri Mittal has been instrumental in involving the private sector, both national and international, in the task of innovation and entrepreneurship development in India. He has represented India at various international forums on innovation and entrepreneurship. With this, I welcome Mr. Harikesh Mittal, and I would like you to say a few words.
Thank you. In fact, first of all, let me thank Professor Prabhat Ranjan for inviting me for this session, and also for the very kind words which both of you, have said about me. Thank you very much. Well, let me start with the matter of concern, which is of our audience. First of all, my greetings to all the young students who have joined the program, the courses. Well, when you join a graduate school, your mind, your eyes are full of dreams. People dream of different things. People dream of most of the young students. I remember my old days. Most of us wanted to get a job when we graduated out of the school. Some of us also wanted to go for higher studies when we went to a graduate school. Some of us also wanted to go back to our family businesses, whatever we had during those times. And very few of us actually wanted to be on our own. So in a cross section of, let's say, if there are 100 students in a class, I would imagine that about 80% of them would always think of taking up a job. And then there'll be another 15% of them who would like to go for higher studies, and the balance, those who would go to their own family business or do something on their own, was only 5%. But in the last 30, 40 years, the scenario is changing. It's not changed completely, but the scenario is changing greatly. Now, you are in your second day of induction. Well, first of all, I must tell you that this is a stage when you are coming out of the boyhood and you are now going to be a man. You are starting that process, that journey, which is there. Similarly for the girls, now from a girl, you are going to be a lady. And it is true that some of us want to continue in our previous avatars of being a girl or a boy. But the sooner we change ourselves, change the gears, I think it will be better. And there is no better way of doing this than becoming a person who is working for himself or herself. You become a complete person when you start working for yourself, or being your own boss, being an entrepreneur. Well, let me begin by sharing a story with you. It's a story about the youngest entrepreneur of the world. He happens to be from India. His name is Suhas Gopinath. He was studying in Bangalore. He was in school. He was only about 11 years old when he thought of doing something on his own. So the first thing he thought of, those days computers, the rage of computers had just begun. So he thought that let me first develop a website for myself. Let me develop a web portal for myself, and then I will see what to do with this. So for developing a web portal, you require two things. Let me tell you briefly a little more about Suhas Gopinath. He became an entrepreneur when he was about 13 years of age. Today, Suhas is about 28 years of age. He has a company which is based mainly out of US and also out of Bangalore. He has more than 800 employees. His company's net worth today is close to $1,000 million. And now let's go back to that story where it all started. He was studying in school and he wanted to develop a portal, a web portal. Now there are two things which are required for developing a portal, mainly, plus other things also. First is you need connectivity to the net. You have to have an internet connection. The second is you also need to hire a space on the web. These are the two basic essentials for starting or developing a portal. So first thing what he did was he found out that there is a cyber cafe near his house. Those days we never had these dongles or Wi-Fis. We only had internet access through internet cafes. And the internet cafe used to charge about 50 rupees for half an hour or so, something in that range, 50 rupees an hour or so for giving you the access to internet. His pocket money was only 125 rupees per month. So regular access, he couldn't have afforded. So he went to a cyber cafe, which is located near his house. And he found out that that cyber cafe used to remain closed between 11 o'clock in the night to 6 o'clock in the morning. So he offered to the owner of that cyber cafe that I will keep your cyber cafe open between 11 o'clock in the night to 6 o'clock in the morning. And the only salary I will take is the free internet time, which I will use during this period of 11 o'clock to 6 o'clock in the morning. And you can advertise your cyber cafe as 24/7 cyber cafe. You can walk in anytime, you can go out anytime. Well, that deal was done. The next problem was how to get space on the internet. So he found out a company in US which used to sell the space on the web. The charges were $80 per annum for hosting your website on their server. So he thought that I can't afford this. So he wrote an email to this company saying that I am a student, 12 years old. I want this space. Can you waive off these charges for me? Well, the company was considerate enough. And mind you, he tried. First of all, let's appreciate that he did not give up. He tried. He wrote a mail to them. And the response came from that company. Well, for the next 6 months, we are waiving off your charges. And we will take a review after 6 months. In the meantime, he worked day in and day out, developed that website. And now the time for review came. But before that, what happened was that his grades in the school started falling because he would remain awake throughout the night. And then Suhas' mother was called to the school and she was told that, see, you have two sons in the school. The elder son, Suhas' elder brother, is doing so well. What is happening to your younger child? He is sleeping in the class. He is not attentive. His grades are falling. So his mother called Suhas. I know that you go out in the night. Where are you, in a bad company? Or so Suhas told her that I am doing this. I want to be an entrepreneur myself. So what she said is, Suhas, put your hand on my head and swear that you are not going to become an entrepreneur. That's the society which discourages you to become an entrepreneur. But he was made of a different stuff. So Suhas said, don't worry, mom, I'll catch up. So now this 6 months review from that company in US came. So he had developed his portal all alone. And Suhas gets an email from this company. Well, the time for review is on. We are enclosing your air ticket and your visa formalities are being done. So you, on such and such date, you come to US and the rest of the details we'll discuss there. Well, Suhas was very happy to get this email. Anybody would be, especially a young student of Suhas' age. His first time he's flying out of the country. So he went to US to meet that company. He was put up in a 3-bedroom flat. And next day or after a couple of days, there was the meeting. So Suhas subsequently shared with me that I can share with you, I was feeling a little awkward staying in that 3-bedroom house all by myself. And in fact, he said, I was a little afraid of staying in that huge accommodation. Well, he went to that place. The discussion happened. The company told Suhas that, well, we will meet all your education cost till the time you want to study, whether you want to do your graduation, post-graduation, doctorate, post-doctorate, all that is on us. And the house where you are staying will be yours for life. And we will ensure your admissions in the top-notch universities in the in US. All that was, Suhas said that the offer was very tempting to me. I almost took that offer. But he then realized that I felt that this portal which I have created is like a baby to me. And you don't sell off your babies. He was in love with that portal. He said, I refused that offer. I came back to India. And then he started attracting traffic to these websites. He shares many intricate details. I have known Suhas almost for the last about 1.5-2 decades. I have known him. So he shares very interesting details of his journey. He said to populate this website, and later on he got into the web in the business of developing websites for smaller companies, small and medium enterprises. So he would he said this is a wrong marketing practice, but let me share with you how people have done it. I'm not suggesting that you follow the same path. He would send out an email to the company as a buyer saying that we are interested in your company. We would like to place an order with you, but give us your website address. We would like to visit your website. The company doesn't have a website. And the second mail immediately goes is that we are developing websites, international quality websites. Are you interested in such and such price? We can develop your website very quickly. And so now the SME or the startup is interested in getting a website developed. So they would immediately jump at that offer. They would do that. He said, we stopped doing it. We knew that this is not an ethical practice. We stopped doing it. But that's how. Now, let me come to the interesting part of the story. What happened? He was successful as a businessman. He was invited by the European Union Parliament to address the European Union Parliament as the youngest entrepreneur of the world. The parliament is in Brussels. So he was invited to Brussels. The appointed time was 11 o'clock in the morning. Suhas was supposed to address the entire European Union Parliament. Well, 11 o'clock, suddenly they started searching for Suhas. 11:10, 11:15, Suhas is nowhere to be seen. And then the murmur started. These Indians, they don't value time. Subsequently, at about 11:20, 11:25, when they were searching for Suhas, Suhas was standing at the main gate of the parliament from 10:30 onwards, because the security won't allow him inside, saying that children are not allowed inside the parliament. So they had stopped Suhas there. Well, Suhas also started studying for his engineering in Bangalore. He, of course, could not complete his studies because his venture was so successful that he had to drop out of. But I would personally any day would give up my course to become like Suhas. It's almost having a business of $1,000 million worth of business, employing more than 800 people. He was not allowed to start a company in India because he was less than 18 years of age. He had established this company in US because that's where he could establish his company, raise money, raise resources. And there are so many interesting incidents about Suhas. When he would go to his college professors, because he would normally run short of attendance because he was busy doing his business. So he would go to the professor with a request to give him some extra attendance. In return, the professor would give him his biodata, saying that, is there a place in your company where I can get employed? So there are so many interesting incidents about, okay, let me stop this story here. And
so one point, Dr. Mittal, actually this point about not being able to open company below the age of 18, has that changed now in India or it is still there?
It is still there. It is not changed drastically. We require minimum, the person should be a major 18 years plus. While in US they allow this, although I must also share with you that Dr. Kalam tried this, he also tried to help Suhas, but somehow he was not, and in the meantime, Suhas also became 18 years of age, so he could start that company in India.
And, right.
It's really amazing.
Because I also met a young boy, Ayani, I called him to one of the TIFEC Foundation Day events. And he was also started at 13 years of age. Now I'm sure that he must be above 18. But he was also like, you know, he was not happy with the school education. So he wanted to, so one of the major contribution was in 3D printing area. And I don't know right now where he is. I will check with him. Probably he's gone out to study somewhere. But he from 13 years of age, he was. But you know, if we compare the countries like US, which is one of the major countries in innovation, some of these important points that you talked about, age issues, and so on, these are very important for the country to discuss, to see that, you know, what ecosystem, what changes should be needed. Should we wait for 18 years, or today people can start very young and go ahead? So that's an important point also to be noted. Now, thank you for sharing this thing. Let's move ahead. Rashmi, please.
Yes. Dr. Mittal, I would like to ask a very important question. There are a lot of young minds who want to develop certain things. So is there any funding which is available for government to help the students?
Okay, you touched a very important point. Let me tell you, today this facility is available right from the school level. There are Niti Aayog has established under the Atal Innovation Mission, Atal Tinkering Labs. There are 5,000 labs which have been established all across the country. And they, where the students can go work on their idea, they can actually build a prototype, test the product, and get mentorship also in these Atal Tinkering Labs. In Department of Science and Technology, we run a program called MANAC. It's Million Minds Augmenting National Aspirations and Knowledge. This is the MANAC program which we run. I handled this program for a little while. Here we are targeting, there are about 7 lakh schools in the country. We want to reach out to each school, and each school is required to do a competition amongst the school and submit 2 or 3 entries at the district level. District level, at the state level, and then at the national level. All these students who, these 1 lakh students out of 1 million ideas which we target, they get a small support of 10,000 rupees each for building their prototype or converting their idea into a prototype. Then from this 1 lakh at the national level, they get an award of close to, I believe, 60 to 70,000 rupees per student, 1,000 of them. And then finally, the winners, there'll be about 100 winners who also get an exposure to go to Japan to build on their talk with the experts, Nobel laureates from Japan. They interact with these top-notch students and help them to actually conceptualize their ideas and products. Apart from this, these are the two programs. Today, each state has its own hackathons. They have programs, innovation contests. These are run by the state governments, and then at the national level also. In fact, when they come to the national level, the awards increase considerably. I have seen startups, entrepreneurs, students who have funded their entire initial journey through the awards which they win in these events, because they have some of those very interesting and unique ideas which they would like to work on. And if the time allows, let me give you a story from the biotech which came out of these awards. This is a story about one young fellow who was a graduate in biotechnology. And he was studying for his MBA at ISB Hyderabad. And he had developed artificial flowers made out of paper, which looked like real flowers, which felt like real flowers, and which smelled like real flowers. What he did was, he coated the paper with a hygroscopic enzyme. Hygroscopic meaning, which absorbs moisture from the air. So this paper would absorb moisture from the air, and when you touch that flower, it will give you that wet feeling, wet cold feeling, which you get by touching a real flower. Using a nanotech spray, the fragrance would last for 3 years. So now you have artificial flowers, which are looking like real flowers, feeling like real flowers, and smelling like real flowers. So he created this product. He was a winner in India competition, national winner in India competition. We sent him to UC Berkeley for a global competition. Now, when we sent him to global competition there, he landed at San Francisco Airport, and he was carrying a bunch of these artificial flowers in his hand because he couldn't have packed those flowers. And he was passing through the quarantine and the customs. So suddenly the quarantine officer shouted at, "Hey, young man, come here. Why are you, where are you going?" So he immediately took out his letter of invitation, this competition. He said, "I am not talking of any of this. Why are you carrying these natural flowers inside the US? Don't you know that you are not allowed to carry any agricultural produce, meat products, etc., flowers, etc., in the US?" He said, "But these are artificial flowers." "But come on, man, they're looking like real flowers, they are feeling like real flowers, they are smelling like real flowers." So he kept on saying, "No, these are artificial flowers." He would have none of them. So he was stopped, he was taken aside. Then they called their botanist and did a dissection, and the botanist gave a certificate that these are artificial flowers. And then everybody was very happy. Nobody had seen those kind of flowers there. So what they did was, there's this display, US Customs and Quarantine, that belt which is there, which is used to regulate the flow of people. Everybody stood in front of that, took a photograph, and everybody posed for, including the customs officials, the quarantine officials, this fellow, and they were very happy, and he was let go. Well, he went to his hotel. Next day was the competition. So in the evening, he went to a florist to pick up a similar looking flower so that he could confuse the jury the next. So he had one flower in his hand, and he was trying to locate a similar 15, 20 minutes. The florist got really irritated. He said, "Come on, man, you want to buy one flower, and for that you are taking so much of time." And then he explained to the florist that this is an artificial flower, and I'm looking for a similar flower. So the florist was experienced enough. He was in the trade. He was experienced enough. He could make out that this is an artificial flower. He immediately asked him, "How many of these you have there?" Said, "Well, about 20 at the most, 25, 30 at the most." Said, "No, I want 100,000 of these flowers. Tell me the cost." So he said, "It's $10 a piece." His cost of manufacture was about less than $5, but he said $10 a piece. He said, "Okay, I'm giving you the order." He said, "Okay, I'm giving you the check and the order." So he collected the order and the check. And next day in the competition, while everybody was going for half an hour presentation, this, that, Subramani presented just four slides. The first slide was that certificate from the botanist that these are artificial flowers. Second was that photograph which he had taken with the quarantine and the customs authorities. Third one was the order which he had received for 100,000 flowers, that is 1 lakh flowers. And the fourth one was the order of that florist of 1 lakh pieces, 100,000 pieces, which he had received. Needless to say, Subramani was a winner in that competition. He was a winner in that competition, in the global competition. And simple idea. Let me also tell you, he is no longer in this business. He's again based out of Bangalore. He is now manufacturing large-scale enzymes. He's moved on from this business. The startups or the entrepreneurs don't stick to one business. They always like to jump and explore other opportunities. So the question started from, what are the opportunities which are available for young students or young startups? Well, my reply would be, you are the creator of those opportunities. You will have to create those opportunities, and these opportunities are plenty these days. I was today listening to the startup awards, which were there at 3:30 today in the afternoon. Startup awards were announced. And Mr. Piyush Goyal, the minister, he was very keen that, see, today in India, you require dual language skills, both national as well as international. He was giving his own example that if I want to travel to, let's say, Tamil Nadu, I need somebody who can speak Tamil as well as either Hindi or English or Marathi. So I feel comfortable there. Similarly, he was talking about foreign languages. Supposing somebody comes from Paris, so people have to. He said, we need lakhs of such people. And during this time of COVID, can we, using the medium of video conferencing, can we train people on lakhs and lakhs of people on language skills, dual language skills? I thought that's a brilliant idea. This is an opportunity which is there.
Dr. Harkesh Mittal, sir, I had a question. Since we are into computer science field, a lot of innovations are there. So certain students want to patent their products. But the thing is, the patent cost is very high. So for students, it is not affordable. So is there any way that they can patent the product in a much lower cost, which the government can help them?
See, there are various schemes available with the government, under which they subsidize the cost of patent filing. There are cells which are available across the country, which also help the students, guide them how to file patents. I am not an expert in patent filing. In fact, that answer can be better given by Professor Bahat Ranjan. He has handled that cell very well. So may I request you, Professor Ranjan, if you could.
Yes, so to promote filing of patents, in fact, I would like to mention one more program of Department of Science and Technology, that's the INSPIRE program. And that also supports innovation from school days. So when I was heading TIFEC, and it's been there for quite some time, the DST funds a scheme through which all the patents of all educational institutes, whether they're private educational institutes, government educational institutes, or government R&D lab, not private R&D lab, government R&D lab, and all the educational institutes, patents can be filed free of cost. And they are both in India and abroad, and they will be maintained free of cost as well in India and abroad. Okay, so there's no scheme like this anywhere in the world, actually. And I used to be chairman of the committee to decide this. Of course, there has to be a merit in this. And so this scheme has been there. The DST has been funding this. The TIFEC used to implement this. In addition to that, as Dr. Mittal said, actually, many of the states have centered to support that. Some of them are also linked to the TIFEC program. So these schemes are available across. Plus, every state government has its own way to support. Within the central government also, different ministries have schemes of similar kind. But there's nothing better than the DST TIFEC program, which is completely free. It's basically we used to take pain out of patents. So basically you give the details, the TIFEC scientists who were there, patent experts, and I would like to mention that among all the patent professors in the country, this is program of DST TIFEC has produced 10% patent professional through a scheme called Women Scientist Scheme, which is a DST scheme. Women scientists A, B, and C. The C scheme was to train women in patents. And 10% of all patent professors in the country are from that scheme. And some of them are with us in DYP International University as well. You know, Dr. Preeti Patil, she is with us. And there are other people who come and teach. They have been part of that. Pune is one of the centers for training of this. So there's plenty of expertise. And in fact, Preeti Patil is helping in a course on technology, commercialization, and entrepreneurship. She's with us. So there's plus the Inspire program that I mentioned, which has different parts starting from school days. In the school time, when the competition is there and you come to national level, the TIFAC team used to actually conduct a survey of all of them and find those who could be, who were patentable. And every year, 15 to 16 we used to find that were useful. And then we try to file patents. Sometimes, of course, it used to happen that we file, the provisional patents and they would not complete all the details needed for the full patent filing. But typically 15 to 16 patents used to be filed from that Inspire program. So there are many other programs across the government system. And Dr. Mittal, as we go along, he will share many of these.
Sir, is there any particular website where our students can get all this information, like what schemes are available? And for women, there are what schemes are there? For under 18 or for engineering students, what schemes are there? So is there a particular website which is maintained by the government of India, which can help our students?
Yeah. Well, the biggest repository is on the Startup India website. That's the biggest repository. Apart from that, there are individual websites like in the Department of Science and Technology, we have the website of National Science and Technology Entrepreneurship Development Board. We have the website of BIRAC in the Department of Biotechnology. We have Atal Innovation Mission in NITI Aayog. And some of these websites also are cross-linked. But the biggest single repository is the Startup India website, which connects all these websites. And for further details, you can always visit these individual websites also. The best thing would be that, first of all, you take a decision what you want to do. If you are clear as to what you want to do is something which today, let me just give you briefly, since you asked this question, there are 300 incubators, technology business incubators located across the country. In city of Pune itself, there are five or six of them. The oldest being is the University of Pune. Then the other one is the National Chemical Laboratory Venture Center. This is another one. And let me also tell you, Venture Center is a very, very high-tech business incubator, one of the best in the country. And
Dr. Premnath handles that.
Dr. Premnath. In fact, I would request you, these days it is not possible for the students to visit the Venture Center. But maybe if you, or if I can also request Dr. Premnath to come and give his thoughts on the ecosystem in Pune. Similarly, Dr. Rajendra Chatale in the University of Pune, he's there. So I can request them to.
I know Dr. Premnath quite well, so I can also request him.
Then you can talk to him. And in fact, the Venture Center Pune actually runs a program on behalf of DST. Where the program is called Entrepreneur in Residence. It's a fellowship program for 1 year. Supposing you are in a high-tech innovative area and you are not taking up a job, you get a sustenance allowance of 30,000 rupees per month. And you can then work on your idea. And if you are successful, well, you continue with that. Otherwise, you can always go back to finding a job. Similarly, there's another program which is run by IIT Bombay. That is Prayas. The name of the program is Prayas, where you get a grant. I'm underlining the word grant of 10 lakh of rupees for building your prototype. It is not a loan. It is not an investment. It is not an equity. It is just grant to build your innovative prototype. We have seen many successful prototypes come out of this Prayas grant. This is handled by IIT Bombay. And the government is trying to do its part you now have market access through GeM, government e-marketplace. There are 4,000, this data is today's data only because the minister spoke about, there are 4,000 startups who have already registered on this GeM portal. They are encouraging everyone else to register for that. They are encouraging people to go abroad for marketing their products. In fact, these innovative entrepreneurs whom they have shortlisted today for the awards, and all those who have made it to the finals, they will all be given opportunities to present this, present their prototypes to all the government departments, the buyers. See, let me tell you, we don't have to be always dependent on government. I remember a young girl who was my trainee 20, 25 years ago. We were doing a women's program in the Vicky Ladies Organization. So there's this young girl, about 20 years of age. So she came in. Since this program was run by Fiki Ladies Organization, these ladies were basically from business houses. And the program was running in September, October. She developed an idea right then and there that this is my idea, I would like to pursue this business. She was a designer by profession. She immediately thought that there are 200 of these ladies who would certainly be gifting something during Diwali times, during festival times. They will give a lot of gifts. So she presented them the packaging of those items, when a sari box, a beautifully carved out sari box, or a jewelry box, or whatever you want to pack, you can pack in those. See, these days, these things are common. But 25, 30 years ago, these things were not so common. She immediately got orders from 100 plus of those ladies, and that is how she managed her margin money for setting up a designer studio subsequently. See, if you keep your ears, eyes and ears open, there are opportunities around you. You have to just sense those opportunities and work on that. Apart from that there are most of these colleges, they start with innovation and entrepreneurship development cell. They make a beginning through that, and then they graduate to a technology business incubator. The idea here is that the college faculty also gets trained in promoting businesses. The ecosystem around that also gets built up. And Pune is one of the vibrant cities as far as entrepreneurial ecosystem is concerned. It is not the same city which it used to be. I know at one point of time, people used to think that Pune is for retired people. No, it is not. It is a very vibrant city. And there are enough opportunities which are available. I think, Rashmi, you would like to ask me. Sorry, you give me the mic, I keep going on. But you yes, can sir. Stop me.
No, Rashmi, Mithil has a couple of more stories to share. So would you like to share those stories first?
Or sure. I would. Well, the last story I will share with you is my own story, which I'll talk in the end. But how the students actually participate in building the ecosystem. I remember a young student from Kerala, Sanjay Vijay Kumar. He once came to my office. He was a youngster, 19, 20 years of age. I knew him earlier. So he knocked at my office door. He didn't even knock. He just opens the door, comes in. And the first question he asked me was, "Mr. Mittal, would you like to start an incubator with me?" I said, this 20-year-old fellow, he doesn't know anything about entrepreneurship, or he is just starting up, and he's talking about starting an incubator with him. So purely to test him, I just said, "Okay, Sanjay, we will give you 50% of the money. You will have to raise other 50% of the money." I, at that point of time, thought that he will never be able to raise that balance 50%, and the government's 50% money also would be saved. So that was my thinking at that point of time. 10 days later, and mind you, he's coming from Trivandrum to Delhi. 10 days later, he comes to my office, again opens the door in the similar manner, leaves him, and he says, "Mr. Mittal, my 50% is arranged. Where is your 50%? I told him, "Sanjay, hold on. Government doesn't work that fast. You have to give a proposal. You have to." We supported that. That's the birth of Startup Village in Kerala. Startup Village is one of the best ecosystems in incubation, and that too in a state which is not known for entrepreneurship. Kerala is known for, at that point of time at least, it was known for its stenographers, it was known for its nurses, it was known for skilled labor. It was never known for entrepreneurship. But this is the power of a youngster. This is the power. It was not the state secretary who came to meet us. It was not the any politician who came to us. It was an individual who actually had this idea, and he started with this. Today, there are about 300 incubators in the country, out of which DST has promoted little more than half. 153 incubators have been promoted by DST. I won't say that all of them are doing excellent, but out of these 153, I would imagine close to about 110 to 120 of them are doing very good work. There are few who have been established very recently. They are still grappling with their issues, but and there are few which have failed also. See, in any journey in entrepreneurship, at the back of our mind, we must always have a plan B ready. If I don't succeed in this, what is the next plan B or plan C also in some cases? So entrepreneurship is a journey where you will fail, you will fall, you will have to again get up and start on. The only advice which I will like to give you is that the fall should not be very severe. If you can control that fall, if you can reduce the impact of that fall, so that you are able to get up again and run. And this can be done by taking help, networks, being cost conscious, being very, very prudent about your work, your activities. And I think this is doable. It is success is not very well. We can complete the other part. The last story I would share you as a concluding remark. Or if you want to hear any number of stories, you can always call me.
No, sir, you can continue with the story.
Okay, I think the story is ended here, but let's finish the other part and then we'll talk about the last two.
Yes.
Okay?
Yes, sir.
In case you have any questions.
Sir, I would like to ask a question. These days, students leave their education sometimes and pursue completely into entrepreneurship. Is this the right thing that they have to do?
Well, there is nothing right or wrong there. See, let me put it this way. The education, number one, opens your horizons. It gives you options. It tells you the possibilities which exist. And it's good to have a safety net. Education also provides you that safety net. But if you are successful, there's no hard and fast rule that you have to be only a graduate or a postgraduate or a researcher to be successful as an entrepreneur. There's no written norm, or there's no proven fact, there's no data in that system. But I am influenced by the culture which I'm brought up. So I attach a lot of importance to education. But not everybody. So it's an individual choice. it's as good a choice that whether I eat chapatis or rice or dhokla or whatever part. It's an individual choice.
I would like to mention something here, if you permit. A very good friend of mine, Rashmi Bansal, the very famous author, Rashmi Bansal. Yes. And she was an IIM Ahmedabad graduate like yourself. 93 she graduated. And stay hungry, stay foolish. So that was commissioned by IIM Ahmedabad. And that was the story of IIM graduates who went on to become successful entrepreneur. So I think the story of 25 of them. And then people told her that why you're only covering IIM people, because there are many more people who have not done degrees from IIM, but they have still been successful. So then she wrote another book, which was Connecting the Dots. And then she talked about women entrepreneurs. There was another book. In fact, I was there in the book release. Then she had another one, which was on social entrepreneurship. So actually, entrepreneurship comes from all kind of background, and it did not be... No, education is not necessarily related to that. No, Dhirubhai Mani was not a person who was well educated, and he set up the largest industry in the country. So if you think of a startup, it was a very successful startup. So, you know, there's no hard and fast rule, as Dr. Mittal said. In fact, I'd just like to add a couple of things. One was the technology development board that Dr. Mittal used to head himself. That supports, I think, up to 10 crores rupees. They support entrepreneurship. And in TIFEC also, from idea to prototype stage, up to 1 crore Sweden program support. So there are so many government schemes supporting this. In fact, at one time I was trying to get all of this on a portal, but I was not successful. So there's plenty of support available. But as Dr. Mittal mentioned, the private venture capitalist system is also very, very strong. And unlike government systems, they're not the stopper simply giving funds. They guide you, actually. They mentor you to make sure that you're successful. So that ecosystem is also developing very well. And maybe I'll have sometime somebody else come and talk about that aspect. In fact, I think day after tomorrow, we have two entrepreneurs from Silicon Valley joining us. One of them was successful in India and now is in Silicon Valley. Other one has been there. So we'll also learn about how Indian ecosystem versus US ecosystem, what are the differences? And we should learn from that, because right now US is the leading innovation country. So that will be excellent. Yeah, please go ahead, Rashmi. Yeah.
Yes, sir. Sir, yeah. I think from my side, this was the last question. Sir, Doctor, can you add your last story with this?
Okay. I normally start with the story. Today, I'm ending with the story. This is my own story. I was studying at IIM Ahmedabad, and I always wanted to be an entrepreneur myself. With a surname like Mittal, what else I could have thought of? I always wanted to be an entrepreneur myself. My business plan was ready. My loan was sanctioned. My industrial shed was allocated. I was very keen that I will graduate and I will go and start my industry. What happened in the second year? This institute came up, Entrepreneurship Development Institute of India. And they organized a program, how to start your own business. That was their mandate, so they were organizing this program. I remember one of my professors, Professor Gupta, he said, since you are going to start your own enterprise and they are organizing this program for 2 days, why don't you go and attend this program? I had never heard of this institute. So I went there, I participated in that program. I was very impressed with one of the speakers there, one Dr. Rawal. He seemed to know everything about small-scale industry. Everything. What are the qualities of an entrepreneur? How the entrepreneur should behave? How do you set up an enterprise, etc.? I was very impressed with that speaker. Well, let me tell you, that was the end of my entrepreneurial dreams. I thought if I work with this professor for 2 years, I will get complete knowledge about small scale industry, and then nobody will be able to beat me in small scale industry. Well, this is about 35 plus years ago. I have all the knowledge about small scale industry, but I have never become an entrepreneur. This is hindsight. Why I did not become an entrepreneur? Because I did not act. Knowledge is important, but action is more important. If you want to do something, you will have to act. Most of us, we spend our time thinking, planning, but without doing action. If you want to become an entrepreneur, start today. Today is the day, right now is the day when you have to take action. And each one of us will have to take our own actions. We can't be dependent on, if he does this, I will then do it. No, I will have to do it. An entrepreneur thinks and takes action. That's, if there's one message which you want to take home today from my talk, take this message that action is important. While knowledge is important, action is important. That's my message. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Dr. Mittal.
Thanks, sir. With this, I would like to end this beautiful session. Dr. Mittal, you have engraced this occasion beautifully. You have answered all our queries. So I would like to extend a beautiful vote of thanks to you, the D.Y. Patil University, for arranging such a beautiful session. Thank you, Professor Prabhat Ranjan, sir, and thank you, Professor Harkishma. Thank you.
Thank you.